From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
I want to wish you all welcome to this, one of our noontime lectures. On behalf of our chief, Dr. Mary Jane Deeb, who is unable to be with us today, and the rest of the African Middle Eastern Division, I wish to welcome you all. I'm Chris Murphy. I'm the head of the Near East section here in the African Middle Eastern Division. The division has three sections. The African section that is concerned with sub-Saharan Africa, both providing reference about that area and developing the collection from sub-Saharan Africa. The Hebraic section, which is responsible for Hebraica and Judaica from all over the world. And the Near East section, which I said, of which I am head. The Near East section is responsible, the staff of the section are responsible for developing the collection from and about all of the Arab countries, Iran, Afghanistan, the countries of the Caucasus, Turkey, and Turkic Central Asia. They are also responsible for developing the collection from and about the Muslims of Western China, of Russia, and of the Balkans. So the purview of the Near East section basically runs from Rabat in the west to Kashgar in the east, from Khartoum in the south to Kazan in the north. The staff of the section, which consists of three professionals who developed the Arabic collection, a specialist for Iran and in the Iranian languages, a specialist for Armenia and Georgian. The specialist position for Turkish is vacant. I actually held that position for 22 and a half years before 6.5 years ago I was promoted to become section head. The collection of the Near East section is primarily books and journals. There are about 480,000 volumes, of which approximately one half are Arabic. About 75,000 each are in Persian and Turkish, Ottoman Turkish, and the rest are in some 36 other languages, including Ingush, a language from the North Caucasus, which has, I think, a dozen volumes. It used to only have 9, so it is growing apace. We receive approximately 20,000 volumes a year. So when my successor makes an introduction in a decade, we'll be up to pretty close to 700,000, somewhat past 750,000 volumes. These noontime lectures are a particularly important aspect of the division and the section's outreach. Well, we are tasked by the Congress of the United States to develop collections from and about the areas for which we are responsible. We are also tasked by Congress to make not only our collections known to the staff of Congress, the federal bureaucracy, and the international scholarly public, but to the general public as well. And these lectures are one of the ways in which we explain, you know, to the general public, who does pay for what we do here, what we are doing and the kinds of work we do. And I'm now going to ask Dr. Muhammad Salhi, who did a lot of the work to set this lecture, to get it going. I'd ask him to come up and introduce today's speaker. Muhammad.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you all for coming. Dr. Jennifer Tobkin earned her PhD in 2011 from the Department of Semitic and Egyptian Languages and Literatures at Catholic University of America. She's currently a teaching assistant professor in the Arabic program at George Washington University. She's taught modern standard Arabic at university level since 2005. Today she will be speaking on Muhammad ibn Dawud, a man of our times, and the Abbasid language of brotherhood. So without further ado, Dr. Tobkin.
Good afternoon. When we speak about the Abbasid period in Arabic literature, we sometimes think of it as the Golden Age. It was a time when the sciences and literary activity flourished, when works of Greek philosophy were translated into Arabic, when Arabic prose literature became a fully mature form. When we speak about the Abbasid period of Arabic literature, a word that we often hear is majlis. The word majlis in modern Arabic can refer to a parliament, or it can refer to a sitting room in a person's house where people receive guests. A majlis is, etymologically speaking, a place for sitting. In the Abbasid period, the majlis was a place and a time for social gatherings. A semi-formal environment in which people discussed ideas and exchanged anecdotes and exchanged poetry. And when we read biographies of people who lived in the Abbasid period, we hear the majlis being mentioned, we hear about conversations that they had in the majlis, witty exchanges, people exchanging verses of poetry. And when you read some of the books from this period, even very serious and very formal books, such as encyclopedias, you can still feel that as these books were being written, people were discussing them with their friends and their personal associates in the majlis. You hear reports that this was something that someone said. People transmitted information face to face. There was a great proliferation of writing and literacy in Abbasid times, but compared to now, it was before the invention of the printing press. People heard books being read out loud. People heard people speaking information. And you knew that what you had written really made an impression, or that your poem really became popular if people quoted it in the majlis. And the Abbasid period saw the writing of books on almost everything. The science of Arabic grammar was a very important subject to study, and it was something that educated people studied. The religious sciences, as well as more specialized disciplines such as philosophy, such as medicine. And there are books about almost everything, but what came to strike me as strange was that there are no books on brotherhood. What I mean by brotherhood is the friendship of two adult men, usually of equal social status. When we're talking about books on brotherhood, we probably mean educated men, gentlemen. Now, why is it strange for there not to be books on brotherhood? This is because there are almost no books that don't rely on brotherhood, that don't mention brotherhood in some way. Brotherhood was the thing that kept the Majlis going. We can hardly have encyclopedias without brotherhood. We can hardly have learning and exchange of information without brotherhood. But yet I didn't find any books on it. So I didn't have just one source to read if I wanted to find out about what people thought about brotherhood in the Abbasid period. But as I looked more closely, I found information on brotherhood in a variety of sources. Now, why am I calling it brotherhood? There are many words for love and friendship in Arabic, many more than there are in English. The book Rawdat al-Muhibbin by Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyah mentions 60 words that could be translated as love. An anonymous source quoted in Kitab al-Zahra by Muhammad ibn Dawud, who died in 910 AD, mentions a hierarchy of types of friendship and love, beginning with istihsan, in which you find the person's qualities pleasing, and ending in walah, which is utter loss of sanity, not even knowing anything, and then everything in between. And I have chosen the word brotherhood based on Muhammad ibn Dawood's use of the word ikha, as well as the fact that the figurative use of the word brother and brothers is striking in Arabic even today. It's certainly not exclusive to Arabic that people should refer to their friends as brothers. But in Arabic, you can also call someone a brother of a characteristic, just as you can call someone a father of a characteristic. You can say Abu some characteristic of the person. For example, there was a famous Arabic poet called Abu Nuwas. One interpretation of his name is that it means father of curly hair, because he had long curly hair when he was young. Another interpretation of his name is that it's a reference to Dhu Nuwas, who was a king of Yemen in pre-Islamic times. It's also possible in Arabic to use the word brother in this way. For example, there is a poem that uses the expression Akhu Ahad, which means someone who has a Ahad, someone who has a covenant, someone who has made a promise. And as we start reading books on social conduct, you see the word brother, meaning someone's associate, meaning someone cares about, very frequently. So I would like to read to you a few excerpts of poems that describe the essential qualities of a brother, not meaning a brother who's biologically related to you, not a sibling, but a brother who is a friend of great importance. This is a part of a poem by Abu Tammam, who lived in the 9th century. وَقُلْتُ أَخِي قَالُوا أَخٌ مِنْ قَرَابَةٍ فَقُلْتُ نَعَمْ إِنَّ الشُّكُولَ أَقَارِبُ نَسِيبِي فِي رَأْيٍ وَعَزَمٍ وَمَذْهَبٍ وَإِنْ بَعَدَتْنَا فِي الْأُصُولِ الْمَنَاسِبُ. I said, my brother. They said, a brother by blood? I said, yes, indeed those of like nature are kin. He was my kinsman in thought, conviction, religion, even though our origins were not the same. And this is by al-Buhri, who was a younger contemporary of Abu Tammam. أخٌ لي لم تتصل نسبتي بقرب أبيه وَلَا أُمِّهِ. A brother of mine, my relationship to him is not through his father's family, nor his mother's. This is Muhammad ibn Dawud complaining of a brother who has mistreated him. لَقَدْ بَعَدْتَ عَنْكَ أَخًا شَقِيقًا عَلَيْكَ فَلَا يَرُرُّكَ حُسْنُ صَبْرِي فَلَوْ جُمِعَ الْأَنَامُ لَكُنْتَ فَرْدًا أَحَبَّهُمْ إِلَيَّ بِكُلِّ سِعْرِ. You have cast aside a full-blooded brother, and do not be fooled by my decorous patience. If all mankind were gathered before me, you alone would be the dearest of them to me by all accounts. This is al-Buhtari. وَأَخٌ لَبِسْتُ الْعِيشَ أَخْضَرَ نَادِرًا بِكَرِيمِ عِشْرَتِهِ وَفَضْلِ إِخَائِهِ. A brother, I have decked my life in the vibrant green of his noble companionship and virtuous brotherhood. Here's Abu Tammam. أَيُّ شَيْءٍ يَكُونُ أَمْلَحَ مِنْ صَبٍّ أَدِيبٍ مُتَيَّمٍ بِأَدِيبِ جَازَ حُكْمِ فِي قَلْبِهِ وَهَوَاهُ بَعْدَمَا جَازَ حُكْمُهُ فِي الْقُلُوبِ كَادَ أَنْ يَكْتُبَ الْهَوَى بَيْنَ عَيْنَيْهِ كِتَابًا هَذَا حَبِيبُ حَبِيبِ غَيْرَ أَنِّي لَوْ كُنْتُ أَعْشَقُ نَفْسِي لَتَنَغَّصْتُ عِشْقَهَا بِالرَّقِيبِ. What in the world could be more beautiful than one man of letters passionately in love with another? I have gained dominion over his heart and his love since he first gained dominion over mine. He almost wrote our love between his eyes with the words, "This is the beloved of a beloved one." Except that, if I were in love with my own soul, I would fear lest a slanderer find out about my love for it. Here's Abu Tammam again. أزور محمدا وإذا التقينا تكلمت الضمائر في الصدور فأرجع لم ألومه ولم يلومني وقد فهم الضمير من الضمير. I visit Muhammad, and when we meet, our thoughts speak within our hearts. I return, I have not blamed him, nor has he blamed me, for one mind has understood another. Is brotherhood love? There was plenty written in Arabic, there has been plenty written in Arabic throughout the centuries, beginning in the early Abbasid period, about love. There are famous stories of the so-called martyrs of love, of people dying from love. When I mentioned encyclopedias, there are plenty of encyclopedias about love. Among them, Tawq al-Hamama by Ibn Hazm, written in the 10th century in Al-Andalus in Spain. Later on in the 14th century, Diwan al-Sababa by Ibn Abi Hajala, who was born in Tlemcen, which is now in Algeria, and spent much of his life in Cairo. Also in the 14th century, Al-Wadih al-Mubin fi dhikri min astushhida min al-Muhibbin, the biographical dictionary of the martyrs of love, as it's called, usually called in English, by Al-Hafidh Mughultai. And these are the books that present love as something noble, that the lovers were truly well-intentioned and that love was a fate that befell them. They were faithful to their loved ones, and in many cases the love was unattainable and they died. There were also plenty of books written against love, that all this thinking about love is morally corrupting. There were religious scholars who cautioned against passionate love, against hawa and ishq, among other terms that were used for either erotic love or simply love that consumes your soul. And among the most famous of these books were Dhamm al-Hawa by Ibn al-Jawzi and Rawdat al-Muhibbin by Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyya, both of whom were religious scholars of the Hanbalite madhab. Beyond that, there were plenty of books on love that were simply light entertainment. Love stories have always been popular in love poetry and perhaps always will be popular. And so those writers who sought to teach some deeper human truth about love really went to great lengths to show that love was simply more than physical attraction. So this is why we see stories about people remaining chaste throughout their whole lives and eventually dying from their love. Among the most famous people to do that was a poet named Jamil al-Udhri, who lived in the 7th century. And his beloved was named Buthayna. There are plenty of other names that get mentioned. Ghaylan ibn Uqba, who was in love with May, Kuthayr, who was in love with Azza, and these poets distinguish themselves by the fact that all of their poetry is about the same woman. But in the minds of some people, it's still a man writing about his love for a woman, and that can only mean one thing. So the fact that brotherhood is a love that is between two males might solve that problem, or it might not, because there was also plenty of Arabic literature written in pre-modern times about men's love and admiration for other men. Often, when you have erotic literature about males, there are clearly defined roles of lover and beloved, and the beloved is usually depicted as younger than the lover. And the fact that young men could be seen as a temptation is attested to by plenty of writings cautioning against keeping the company of handsome young men, just as there are writings cautioning against keeping the company of women. It's even said that Sibawayh, who was one of the greatest grammarians of the Arabic language, he wrote a 29-volume book called al-Kitab, which is the definitive book on Arabic grammar. He was a student of al-Khalil ibn Ahmad, the author of Kitab al-Ain, which was an Arabic dictionary, perhaps the first Arabic dictionary. It's said that when Sibawayh was studying, that he veiled his face in the presence of his teacher for reasons of modesty. And therefore, when Arabic writers wrote about brotherhood, they went to great lengths to show that these are both gentlemen who are social equals. This is not a situation where it could simply be physical attraction. So the brothers, first of all, we have the word brother. They're depicted as being of similar age and similar educational level. In some ways, brotherhood bears comparison to the Aristotelian friendship of the best. Brotherhood is a morally wholesome friendship that seeks virtue and that seeks the good. In fact, there was a saying in Arabic that two rational people love each other because they're alike in reason, but two foolish people do not love each other because they're alike in foolishness. Al-Jahid, who died in 868 AD, who's most famous for being a Mu'tazilite, which was a type of Islamic thought that was influenced by Greek philosophy, said that the basis of friendship is thiqa, which is trustworthiness or credibility. And the basis of trustworthiness is knowledge. So therefore, an educated, knowledgeable person is the best friend. Another book in which we find insights into brotherhood is Adab al-Kabir by Ibn al-Muqaffa'. Ibn al-Muqaffa'a died in 756 AD, shortly after the Abbasids came to power, several years after the Abbasids came to power. Ibn al-Muqaffa'a was a convert to Islam from Zoroastrianism. He translated texts from Persian into Arabic, most famously Kalila wa Dimna. And Ibn al-Muqaffa'a, throughout his writings, was interested in statecraft and in the conduct of rulers, and Adab al-Kabir does deal with that subject, does contain advice for rulers. It does contain advice for courtiers in their dealings with rulers, but the largest part of the book contains guidance for brothers. It contains advice for gentlemen interacting with other gentlemen. And it's clear in Adab al-Kabir that this is truly not at its root a book on morals. It's a book on social etiquette. It is a book on how to be likable. It's a book on socially advantageous conduct rather than on virtue. And among the pieces of advice Ibn al-Muqaffa'a gives to his readers are advice on the etiquette of listening to stories one has heard before, interacting with acquaintances one does not particularly like, but whom one's brother regards highly, avoiding reviling people or nations with whom one's interlocutors might be associated, eschewing repeated praise of things for which one's brothers do not share one's enthusiasm. As for apologies, Ibn al-Muqaffa'a advises his readers, only apologize to someone whose forgiveness you want. Yet he also advises his readers of the importance of graciously accepting a brother's apology unless the relationship is beyond repair. And he also says that one should not become angry with one's brother before giving him a chance to apologize. This is, in my opinion, one of the most insightful pieces of advice in Adab al-Kabir. In fact, it seems a little bit like something we might see published on Yahoo Shine, or perhaps should see published on Yahoo Shine. If you see your friend with your enemy, do not let it make you angry, for he can only be one of two types of men. If he is a man you trust intimately, then it is most advantageous that to you that he be as close as possible to your enemy, so that he may avert evil from you, or shield you from trouble, or disclose confidential information to you. If he is not among your closest brothers, then what right do you have to keep him away from other people and to forbid him to associate with anyone except as it pleases you? Another writer who wrote about brotherhood was Kashajim, who died in 961 AD. Kashajim was a court poet of Saif ad-Dawla, who was the ruler of Halab at this time. And Kashajim, throughout his career, wrote books about various aspects of palace life, from hunting to fine food. But the book of his in which we see the most information about brotherhood is called Adab al-Nadim. A Nadim is, for all practical purposes, a professional friend of a ruler. The Nadim's job is to accompany the ruler in assorted leisure activities and to conduct himself in the most agreeable way at all times. To give you some examples of things that the Nadim might do, I will read you the table of contents of Kushajim's Edeb and Nadim. Edeb and Nadim means the conduct of the Nadim. So it's a book of advice on how to be a good Nadim. So here are the chapters. Praise of the Nadim and the enumeration of his virtues and the censure of drinking wine in solitude. Character traits and attributes of the Nadim. Being called to be a Nadim. Drinking companions, many and few. Listening to music. Conversation. Washing hands. Passing around the cup. Excess and insufficiency. Requesting the cup when drinking wine. The Nadim's physical appearance and his obligations to his master. The master's obligations to his Nadim. Chess etiquette. Keshajim also advises the Nadim that he should behave in a way that suits his master's every mood. He should always dress nicely, but not too ostentatiously, in case his master might ask him to change his clothes at some point during the evening, so as not to draw attention to this fact. There is a poem in Edeb and Nadim about how drinking together makes drinking companions into brothers. لم يكن بيننا رضاع ولكن ولدت بيننا المدام رضاعا إن يكن أول المدام رضاعا أو يكن آخر المدام صداعا فلها بين ذا وذاك حنات وصفها بالسرور لن يستطاع. We were not nursed by the same woman, but wine made us nursery mates. If the first draft of wine is mother's milk, and the last draft of wine is a hangover, then between the two are such pleasures, to describe them as happiness would not suffice. There's also a story in Edeb and Nadim that mixes the martyrs of love motif with the world of the Nadim. Al-Walid ibn Uqba remained as the Nadim of Abu Zubayd al-Ta'i, treating him as a friend, even after he was dismissed because of a single lapse of good conduct, which he could not have avoided. And he continued to honor Abu Zubayd and praise him, and he never preferred anyone else over him until Abu Zubayd's death. Then Al-Walid was overcome with great despair over him until he became ill, and it is said that he was buried beside him. Ashja'a ibn Amr al-Salmi passed by their graves, and two friends of his, named Hamza and Sa'id, were with him. He stopped at the two graves and said, I passed by the bones of Abu Zubayd, captive beneath barren earth. A Nadim of Al-Walid, he settled here and became the neighbor of the grave of Al-Walid. I know not to whom death will come first, to Ashja'a, or to Hamza, or Sa'id. And they died in that order, one after the other. Finally, we move to someone that I consider the poet of brotherhood, Muhammad ibn Dawud al-Isfahani. In Arabic, certain poets are associated with certain genres or certain motifs in poetry. Abu Nuwas, who was a Nadim of the Caliph al-Amin, is associated with wine poetry, for example, and also hunting poetry, both Nadim activities. Jamil al-Udhri is associated with chaste love and lifelong fidelity and the poetry about that. It is my opinion that Muhammad ibn Dawud is the poet of brotherhood in Arabic literature. Ibn Dawud's poems appear in Kitab al-Zahra, which is an anthology of Arabic poetry compiled by Ibn Dawud. It contains many different poems. It contains poems by pre-Islamic poets. It contains poems by some of the most popular Abbasid poets, such as Abu Tamam, al-Buhtari, Abu Nuwas. And the poems in Kitab al-Zahra all broadly fall into the genre of ghazal, which is love poetry. Ghazal was frequently recited in the majlis. It's some of the easiest poetry to memorize, some of the easiest poetry to fit to the situation and quote. So tall tales grew up around Ibn Dawud after his death, that he died of love for a friend named Muhammad ibn Jami'. And this is why he included, this is why he wrote Kitab al-Zahra, and this is why he included his poems in Kitab al-Zahra under a pseudonym, Ba'd Ahl Hadha al-Asr, a man of our times. It is my opinion that Ibn Dawud wrote the man of our times poems simply to entertain his friends in the majlis, as they were talking about brotherhood, and that he included them in Kitab al-Zahra, along with other anonymous poems and other poems by under vague pseudonyms that may have been written by people who were not professional poets and therefore were not famous for their poetry. Ibn Dawud was a judge by profession. The action of his as a judge that has become the most famous, although none of his works on jurisprudence survive in their entirety, is his fatwa against the Sufi al-Hallaj. He was one of the judges who wrote fatwas against al-Hallaj, and al-Hallaj was eventually executed 12 years after Ibn Dawud's death. Throughout the centuries, Ibn Dawud has been more famous for being a martyr of love and for writing the fatwa against al-Hallaj than for his poetry. But it is my opinion that the Man of Our Times poems serve a similar purpose to the contents of books like Adab al-Kabir and Al-Adab and Adab al-Nadim about advice on being a brother. In fact, Ibn Dawud makes some statements in the introduction to Kitab al-Zahra about why advice, why brothers are in need of advice, why the world could use some good brothers. Know that those who are content with their brothers are few these days. The only ones who remain are those who do things half-heartedly and do not act justly. If you give preference to them, they hesitate to receive your preferential treatment. When you treat them with respect, they abandon you. As long as they have any hopes or fears about you, they stay away from you. If neither of these two conditions, their hopes or their fears, is present, they do not abide by your brotherhood or keep their promise of fidelity. And therefore, he proposes Kitab al-Zahra as the perfect brother. I have decided, because of my overpowering longing for you, even as you have been inclined to inquire about the states of lovers, to send you a companion, and the word he uses for companion is Nadim, that will show you the states of those who have come before you and bring you the news of those from the past. It will share your enthusiasm and run out of energy only when you do. It will be near to you when you permit it, and it will be far away when you exile it. It will not regard you scornfully when you need it. It will not turn away from you when you turn away from it and mistreat it. It will not keep your secrets instead of revealing them. Rather, it would never cross your companion's mind to reveal them. Your companion is not too proud to let you ask it questions, and it will not be angry with you when you are afraid or when it is tired. If you give it to any brother you like, you will never lose him from among your circle of friends. If you devote yourself to it to the exclusion of your other friends, it will allow you to rise above your peers. I will conclude with a poem written by Ibn Dawud under the pseudonym A Man of Our Times, in which he, assuming that the real or fictional brother to whom he is writing is a rational person and will be moved by these arguments, tries to convince his brother to treat him justly. أَفِي الْعَدْلِ أَنْ تَنْهَى أَخَاكَ عَنِ الشُّكْرِ وَيَنْأَى فَلَا يُنْهَى عَنِ النَّأْيِ وَالْهَجْرِ أَجَلْ أَنَّ ذَا عَدْلٌ عَلَى الصَّبِّ فِي الْهَوَى إِذَا كَانَ لَا يُنْجِيهِ مِنْهُ سِوَى الْعُذْرِ أَيَجْمُلُ فِي حَقِّ الْجِوَارِ دَعِي الْهَوَى أَنْ أَبْقَى عَلَى ظَهْرِ الْعِشَاءِ إِلَى الْفَجْرِ أُرَاعِي نُجُومًا لَمْ أُوَكَّلْ بِرَاعِيهَا وَأُذْكِيَ هَوًا فِي الْقَلْبِ أَذْكَى مِنَ الْجَمْرِ وَأَنْتَ أَخٌ لِي قادر أن تزيل ما أقاسيه لا تدري بما بي أو تدري تبيت خلي القلب مما أجنه كما أنا خلو في هواك من الصبر وإني أدري أن في الصبر راحة ولكن إنفاقي على الصبر من عمري أراني إذا واصلت ساءتك عشرتي وإن غبت لم أخطر ببال ولا فكري أحين تناهى الود واتصل الهوى وصرت شريكي في السريرة والجهر مللت إخائي وطرحت مودتي وأقصيتني حتى تحيرت في أمري. Is it within the bounds of justice to forbid your brother to thank you and to cast him aside, but not to forbid him from rejection and exile? Yes, for one in love, it is just and within the bounds of love, when nothing can save him except to receive pardon. Is it proper, according to the laws of neighborliness, let alone love, that I should be left to spend the night from the night prayer until the pre-dawn prayer, keeping watch over the stars, whose pasture has not been entrusted to me? And love is a flame in my heart, hotter than burning coals? You are a brother to me. You have the power to alleviate my sorrow. But do you or do you not know what I am enduring? At night, your heart is devoid of the likes of my ordeal. Just as I, on account of your love, am devoid of patience. I know that in patience lies solace, but being so patient has shortened my life. Behold, when I am with you, you find my company loathsome, and when I am away, not a single thought of me crosses your mind. Behold, when friendship increased until it became love, and you became my companion in private and public, you tired of my brotherhood and cast aside my friendship and dismissed me until I became confounded. Here is one more poem in which Ibn Dawud, speaking as his fictional alter ego, the man of our times, mentions some of the things that the Nadim would be familiar with, and makes the point that his brotherhood, subtly makes the point that his brotherhood with the brother to whom he is addressing is better than any of the pleasures that one might encounter in the majlis with one's nadim. كأن رقيبا منك يرعى خواطري وآخر يرعى ناظري ولساني فما عاينت عيناي بعدك منظرا يسوءك إلا قلت قدر مقاني ولا بدرت من في بعدك مزحة لغيرك إلا قلت قد سمعاني ولا خطرت من ذكر غيرك خطرة على القلب إلا الرجاء بعناني إذا ما تسلى الغايرون عن الهوى بشرب مدام أو سماع قياني وجدت الذي يسلي سواي يشوقني إلى قربكم حتى أمل مكاني وفتيان صدق قد سئمت لقاءهم وعففت طرفي عنهم ولساني وما زهد أسلى عنهم غير أنني أراك على كل الجهات تراني. It is as though you have sent a spy to watch over my thoughts, and one to follow my gaze and to keep track of what I say. Since you left me, whenever I see anything that would offend you, I say, the spies have seen me. If ever a jesting remark escapes my lips since you have gone, I say, the spies have heard me. Every time a thought of someone else comes to my mind, the spies pull on the reins. Whereas ardent lovers divert themselves from their love by drinking wine or listening to singing maidens, I find that things that would console someone else only increase my longing to be near you, and I grow restless of being where I am. Honest young men, I have grown tired of their company. I have chastely restrained my eyes from them and my tongue. Whenever my countenance offers me consolation, just then I see you everywhere I look. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Tobkin. Any questions? We have a few minutes for questions and answers.
Not as far as I know. While some ideas from the Greco-Roman period were popular in Arabic thought in this period, I do not know of any translations of Greek or Latin poetry into Arabic. It is very possible that some of the same ideas were present because poets like Ovid and poets like Abu Tamam and Ibn Dawud may have read some of the same sources in different languages. But as far as I know, there is no direct connection between the poetry. Yes. Well, to answer the first question, I think the fact that we have, I think the name Muslim Brotherhood definitely does stem from all the ways that the word brother is used in Arabic. And in fact, in Arabic, the Muslim Brotherhood is called al-Ikhwan al-Muslimun, which is the Muslim brothers. So I think that this reflects the figurative usage of the word brother is still going strong in Arabic. As far as female poets writing about sisterhood, I have not seen it, but I have not really looked for it. That would be a good thing to research. The poetry by female poets in Kitab al-Zahra tends to focus on dying from love. You see female poets writing about their sadness for men that they loved, sometimes male relatives, sometimes in the interest of chastity. Some of the poems that are attached to female poets are for male relatives. For example, Al-Khansa, who was pre-Islamic or early Islamic, her famous poem is an elegy on the death of her brother. But in Kitab al-Zahra, we see poems about usually not famous, usually unnamed or first name only women who were secretly in love with a man, and then she died when she heard news of his death, and things like that. And there are poems in Kitab al-Zahra by named women just speaking about love, and they just say I and you. There are no names. We don't have much backstory about it, or at least modern readers don't. It's possible that Ibn Dawud's original audience would have known more about these names.
This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress. Visit us at loc.gov.